Hello everyone, my name is Dmitry Vlinov. I'm a postdoc at the Institute of Astrophysics of Foundation of Research and Technology Hellas. I would like to present our work entitled Optical Polarization Properties of AGN with Significant Villebye Gaia Offsets. This work has been done in collaboration with Yuri Yurievich Kovalev, Daria Zobnina and Alexander Plavin. I will start with this famous AGN M87 that you can see on the background image of this slide, where you can also spot this beautiful optical long jet. As far as we know, this source is one of only 15 active galactic nuclei where the optical jet can be observed and resolved. And on the left you can see a table containing the names of these 15 sources, together with their angular scales of their jets, and you can also see that all these sources have kiloparsec scale jets. In this work we introduce a new piece of evidence to the already existing one that there is a large population of active galactic nuclei with milliarcsecond scale jets in the optical. Thanks to the European Space Agency Gaia mission, for the first time we can probe these newly discovered optical jets. And here on the right I show a histogram of their length in milliarcseconds. But first, before going to our new results, I will show the already existing evidence that such jets are real. My collaborators in this work has recently published several papers on the offsets between VLBI and Gaia positions of AGN. We have cross-matched the radio fundamental catalog and the Gaia catalogs. What we have found is that there are over 9,000 common sources between these catalogs, and 9% of these sources have significant offsets between their positions in the radio and optical. Here on top of the slide you can see four examples of such offsets. The black ellipses, they correspond to radio and optical positions from the two catalogs. The blue arrow is the vector of the VLBI to Gaia offset, and the green arrow is the jet direction. What has been shown in these papers is that when you plot the distribution of the angle, which is called psi here, between the green and the blue arrow, you can see that there are clear and significant peaks at psi equals 0 and at psi equals 180. So these two cases correspond when the Gaia photocenter is shifted downstream from the radio core, it's psi 0, and the opposite situation when psi is equal 180 is when the optical photocenter is shifted upstream from the radio core. And if you stringent the constraints on the uncertainties of these vectors, you see that the two peaks at 0 and 180 become more and more significant, more and more prominent. This by itself is already a strong indication that the VLBI to Gaia offsets have a physical nature. Plavin and co-authors demonstrated that VLBI Gaia offsets downstream of the jet can be of any length up to 50 milliarcseconds, which corresponds to 200 parsecs in the projected distance, while the upstream offsets can reach only roughly 5 milliarcseconds, which corresponds to 20 parsecs in the projected distance. Here we come to the interpretation of these offsets. It is thought that the VLBI to Gaia offsets downstream of the jet are produced by the extended optical jet emission which terminates in the total flux and shifts the photocenter of the optical emission downstream from the central engine, while in the case of upstream offsets the emission is dominated by the accretion disk, and in this case the offset is not zero because typically the VLBI radio core is shifted from the central engine downstream by several parsecs or up to several dozens of parsecs, and this happens due to opacity effects. This is another plot from Plavin et al. 2019. It supports the suggested interpretation of VLBI and Gaia offsets. This panel on the left shows the distribution of sources over the range of redshifts and the values of the angle between the VLBI and Gaia offset and the jet direction. It shows that the downstream offsets can be observed in sources with any redshift, while the upstream offsets occur only in sources with redshifts 1.5 and higher. This is well consistent with the fact that the accretion disk emission peaks typically around 110 nanometers, so it doesn't enter the Gaia bandpass. But when we reach the redshifts 1.5 and higher, this peak of accretion disk emission enters the blue Gaia bandpass, so the accretion disk can be dominating the overall emission. And then we can observe the upstream offset of the optical photocenter with respect to the VLBI core. similar situation is observed for Gaia colors. So Gaia has two band passes, the blue one and the red one. So when we calculate the difference of magnitudes between the two band passes for the sources, we see that the downstream offsets occur in sources of any color. This is presumably happens because the emission of a jet can have any color from infrared to ultraviolet, because it depends on the synchrotron position peak. While the upstream offsets happen only in blue sources. This is again happens because the accretion disk emission can be redshifted to the red Gaia band pass only for sources with very high redshifts, 4.5 and higher, and there are only very few sources with these high redshifts in the considered sample. Okay, now we reach the current work and the optical polarization of AGN. If the suggested hypothesis explaining real Gaia offsets is correct, then we expect very different polarization signatures in the case of upstream and downstream offsets. In the first case, we are supposedly observing the emission of the accretion disk, and in this case, the polarization is produced by scattering in the atmosphere of the accretion disk. But since our sample of sources by construction is dominated by type 1 AGN, so we observe most of them close to the axis of the jet and supposedly of the accretion disk. So we observe a very symmetric situation, and even if the polarization due to scattering is present, it will be mostly cancelled out, so we expect to observe only very low level of polarization in the optical band. In the opposite case, when the Wilbye Gaia offset is pointed downstream, we are supposedly observing the synchrotron emission coming from the jet. In this case, we expect a very high level of optical polarization, because we know from theoretical works that the synchrotron can be up to 80% polarized in the optically thin case in the ideal situation. So in order to check this hypothesis, we collected publicly available optical polarimetric data. We collected data from these two monitoring programs that focus mostly on blazars. This is Robopol and Kanata. And also we added data from these two papers that have single epoch observations and some historic data. So in total, we managed to collect data for 535 active galactic nuclei in two bands, V and R bands. We don't distinguish these two bands because they are located quite close, and typically the polarization parameters are equal within uncertainties of measurements in these two bands. So among these 535 sources, 287 are present in the Wilbye Gaia offset sample that has been discussed in previous slides. Now, if we split this sample of 287 AGN with known optical polarization into three subsamples, subsample with Wilbye to Gaia offsets pointed downstream, upstream, and the third subsample with all other directions of offset, and if we plot the distribution of optical fractional polarization in these three subsamples, we will see exactly what we expected. The subsample with downstream offsets has typically much higher fractional polarization compared to the subsample with upstream offsets, where the level of polarization is below 2% for most of the sources in the sample, with only a few exceptions. And the third subsample has fractional polarization more or less uniformly distributed in this range. So this is the main finding of this work. Using a totally independent data set, using an independent observable, we confirmed the hypothesis that the Wilbye Gaia offsets are caused by different substructures of AGN dominating in the total flux. So in one case, it's the dominating extended jet in the optical, and in the other case, it's a central engine dominating the total flux. And in this plot on the bottom right, we plot basically the same, but in slightly different terms. Here we find the median fractional polarization for each of these three samples and plot it together with the uncertainties of these median values. And also we separate two subclasses of AGN, flat spectrum radio quasars and VLX sources. And as you can see here, our finding stands also for FSRQs separately. So this flat spectrum radio quasars with downstream Wilbye Gaia offsets have on average higher polarization in the optical than the sources with upstream offsets. This plot on the left shows how the position angle of a polarization behaves among the sources of the three samples. We count this position angle with respect to the jet direction, and we see that there is a prominent peak for the downstream sample at zero. This means that the polarization plane is parallel to the jet direction. And this peak at zero is doubtful in the two other samples. So in order to assess the significance of this peak, we use the bootstrap method, and in this table we show the probabilities that this peak is real. So for the downstream sample, this probability is higher than 0.999, while for the other two samples it's not so significant. So this orientation of the polarization plane with respect to the jet direction is consistent with the toroidal magnetic field in the jet. And here on top, on the bottom right, I show just an example source, one of the sources from this downstream sample. This is a dirty Hubble Space Telescope image. All little spots are cosmic rays. There was no cleaning performed here. The source, one of the EGN, is marked by this cross, and on the left top corner, there is just a field star. So visually, the EGN and the field star are very similar, have very similar PSF. And in fact, this image is taken from this work that I cite here. There was no host galaxy found in this EGN, even from this Hubble Space Telescope image. So this source is really quasi-stellar in the optical. At the same time, on the right panel, I show an image from the Mojave program. This is a 15 gigahertz image, radio map, and the cyan line here shows the offset of the optical photocenter from Gaia with respect to the radio core at 15 gigahertz. So as you can see, this offset is very much parallel to the average jet direction, which is shown by this light green arrow. Moreover, the red arrow has an arbitrary length, but its direction shows the optical polarization plane in this source. And the fractional polarization in the optical of this source is over 17%. So as you see, all three arrows are very, very aligned. So we believe that this shift of a Gaia photocenter is produced by an optical jet somewhat twice larger in length than the shift of LBI to Gaia position, twice larger because Gaia position corresponds to the optical photocenter, so there must be similarly long emission on the other side from the photocenter. What is next? First of all, we started a single epoch survey in optical polarization of AGN with significant LBI Gaia offsets. So far, we managed to observe 50 sources using Force 2 polarimeter at VLT, around 15 sources using CAFOS at the 2.2 meter Kaha telescope. And we run this program as a filler program using a Robopol polarimeter at the Skinnakas Observatory. And so far, we managed to observe around 40 sources here. Also, we hope that this project called Pacify will start observations somewhere next spring. The main intention of this survey is to observe several millions of stars towards galactic caps using two wide field optical polarimeters in the northern and in the southern hemispheres. So the main idea of this project is to perform a 3D tomography of the magnetic field in the galaxy in order to clean out the foreground polarized emission from the CMB maps. But as a byproduct, it will observe around 350 sources with significant LBI Gaia offsets just because they fall in the zone of interest of this project. So we hope that at least a couple of hundred of these sources will have significant polarization measurements. But what is more important is monitoring. On the right-hand side in this map, you can see what is called Gaia scanning law. So this is basically, this map demonstrates with a color how many times each point on the sky will be revisited by Gaia during its operation. And it follows from this map that on average, every source in the sky will be observed around 70 times during the 5 years of the Gaia main mission program. So we find it very important to start monitoring in optical polarization the sources with significant LBI Gaia offsets, because these rows of this astrometric data will be released in one of the future Gaia data releases. So together with optical polarization, this will be an invaluable information that will allow to discriminate the disk and jet in the overall optical emission of active galactic nuclei. And we strongly encourage your people who are interested in polarimetry of AGN and who have access to polarimeters to start this sort of monitoring in polarization.
Currently, the monitoring data from Gaia is not available, but the Gaia collaboration has an alert system available for this link, where we can see that every 16 days, roughly, there is an alert about flaring AGN or QSO type source. Here I show one of the examples of such alerts. Currently, we only can see the photometry, the light curve, but we know that each of these photometric measurements in future will also be complemented with accurate astrometry, accurate position measurements, and we expect to see the so-called jitter, the change of a slight change of a position of a photometric center with respect to the radio core. And if such measurements are complemented with polarimetric monitoring, we believe that we can solve immediately a number of problems related to the jet's physics if we combine these data sets. And a couple of such problems I show in the following two slides. The first example is about nature of optical orphan flares. Here on top you see two light curves. The first one is a gamma ray flux from Fermi, and the second one is optical magnitudes. They correspond to this bright laser PKSO208. And you can see in this light curve that around MGD 5200 there is a prominent flare in the optical, but at the same time in the gamma rays there is no increase in the flux. These kind of flares are called optical orphan flares, and the nature of these events in AGN is unclear. So there are several options. For example, they can be produced when the magnetic field in the jet changes, at the same time the number of emitting electrons and the Doppler factor remain constant. Or on the other hand, they can be produced in the accretion disk. So in this case, we are supposed to see the rise in the optical emission, but no increase in the gamma rays, because the gamma ray emission zone is presumably produced downstream of the jet in the zone unrelated to the accretion disk. If our interpretation of VLBI Gaia offsets is correct, and we don't have doubts that it is, and if in this kind of event we had simultaneous astrometric Gaia data and polarimetric optical data, we could potentially discriminate between these two models, and we could understand what actually is behind these flares, how they are produced. Because in the first case, if these flares produced in the jet by the change of magnetic field, we would expect that the optical photocenter, according to Gaia data, would shift downstream of the jet. And at the same time, if it's caused by the magnetic field change, we would expect that the polarization, optical polarization, would change both the fractional polarization and the position angle. On the other hand, if these kind of flares are produced in the accretion disk, then we would expect to see that the optical photocenter, according to Gaia data, shifts in the opposite direction, upstream of the jet towards the central engine near the maximum of this flare. And as I demonstrated before, at the same time, if this emission is dominated by the accretion disk, we would expect to see the depolarization at the peak of the flux, at the flux peak. So we expect to solve the nature of these events in future when we have simultaneous Gaia monitoring data and polarimetry. Another phenomenon that is observed in AGN but doesn't have a clear theoretical explanation is so-called optical polarization plane rotations in blazers. We know that at least some blazers once in a while exhibit long, smooth and continuous rotations of an optical polarization plane that can reach several hundreds of degrees. You can see a talk on these kind of events by Sebastian Kilman in this conference. There are multiple mechanisms that are able to explain these kind of events, and I list 12 of these possibilities in this slide. Unfortunately, so far we were not able to discriminate between these models, but now when we have a totally new observable in our hands, which is the position of the optical photocenter, we could potentially try to discriminate among these models using this new observable. So, for example, if the model number 4 takes place in nature, then the polarization plane rotations are produced by an emission feature moving along the jet that traces different parts of the jet where the magnetic field is oriented different ways, and that produces the polarization rotation. But at the same time, we would expect that this emission feature dominates in the total flux. So supposedly it should exhibit a motion, a radial motion of an optical photocenter along the EVPA rotation event. On the other hand, if a model number 5 takes place in nature, then we would potentially expect to see some non-radial motions of optical photocenter in Gaia data on curves of polarization plane rotation events. It will be probably hard to see this kind of motions of photocenter on an event-by-event basis because the single measurement uncertainties of the position should be relatively large. But we can try to find signatures of these events on a statistical basis in Gaia data. But again, this needs a simultaneous polarization monitoring in the optical band. Studies of VLBI Gaia offsets in AGN can have a very important practical implication. The point here is that the optical reference frame created by Gaia is tied to the radio international celestial reference frame through coordinates of less than 3,000 most stable and most compact active galactic nuclei. But we know that according to this work that almost half of these most stable sources they have VLBI to Gaia offsets that exceed 1 milliarcsecond. So studying their astrophysical reasons of these offsets and their evolution, we can potentially improve this tie between the two reference frame and increase their accuracy in future. I reached my final slide and here are my conclusions. We have demonstrated that active galactic nuclei with VLBI to Gaia offsets pointed upstream the jet have significantly lower optical polarization compared to AGN with downstream offsets. This finding confirms that the VLBI to Gaia offsets have a physical origin, which in turn opens an entirely new window for probing AGN physics. This work has been recently published in MNRAS Letters. You can see the link to the paper in this slide. And to this paper we attached a list of over 1,000 active galactic nuclei with significant VLBI Gaia offsets containing their coordinates and parameters. Thank you for your attention.